Let's practice finding intervals of concavity and inflection points. So here are the directions for this example. Determine the intervals on which the following function is concave up or down, and identify any inflection points. And the function is f of x equals 5x to the fourth minus 20x cubed plus 13. Okay, so we want to find intervals of concavity and inflection points. And remember, inflection points are the places where the function changes concavity. So the first step is just knowing that information about the concavity of a function is contained in the second derivative. So we're going to be working a lot with the second derivative in this problem. Okay, so where the second derivative is positive, the function is concave up, and where the second derivative is negative, the function is concave down. And then inflection points are just any points where that concavity changes. So the first step then is to actually calculate the second derivative of this function. So let's go ahead and do that. So of course we have to start by taking the first derivative. So the first derivative would be 20x cubed minus 60x squared plus 0. Okay, and then we take the second derivative, which is just the derivative of the first derivative. And if we do that, we get 60x squared minus 120x. Okay, so this is our second derivative. Now what we're going to do next is very similar to the process we used to find intervals of increasing and decreasing in local extrema, except we're looking for something different. But what we want to do is find the places where the second derivative either equals zero or does not exist. And these are going to be the only possible places where the concavity would change. So it's like the critical points, except we're finding them for the second derivative instead of the first. Okay, so first of all, there are no places where the second derivative does not exist in this case. Because it's just a quadratic, it's continuous for all x's. Okay, so I'll just make a note of that here. So no points where the second derivative does not exist. So next we move on to finding the places where it equals zero. So I need to solve the equation 0 equals 60x squared minus 120x. All right, so looks like I can pull out a 60 and an x and then be left with x minus 2. Okay, so that factored pretty nicely. And then, of course, to finish solving it, we just need to set each factor equal to 0. So we get 60x equals 0 and x minus 2 equals 0. And we end up with solutions of x equals 0 and x equals 2. So these are possible inflection points. They aren't necessarily inflection points. Just like when we find the zeros of the first derivative, those are possible max and mins, but not necessarily. We still have to check it. Same thing here. These are possible inflection points, but we need to check and see what the behavior actually is. So I'm going to kind of use the same chart, the same chart setup that I would for the first derivative test. So I'm going to put these numbers on a number line. These are x values. But what I'm actually going to be testing here is the sign of the second derivative, because that's what I care about in this case. Okay, so remember the second derivative in factored form is 60x times x minus 2. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to check in each of these intervals just the sign of the second derivative. So I don't care what the value actually is. I just care about the sign. So kind of the shortcut I do is use a factored form, and then so I'd pick a test point. So in this first interval, for example, I could pick negative 1, and then I just look at the sign of each factor. So if I plug in negative 1 to this factored form, 60 times negative 1 is a negative. Negative 1 minus 3 is a negative. So I have a negative times a negative, which is a positive. Okay, and then our next interval is numbers between 0 and 2. So I could pick 1, and then I would get a positive times a negative, which would give me a negative overall. And then finally, I could pick 3 And that would give me a positive times a positive, or a positive overall. Okay, so what we've done so far is found the sine of the second derivative on each of three intervals. But what does this actually tell us about the function? So this tells us about the concavity of the function. So let me make another little line up here, and let's write down what we now know about the behavior of the original function. So wherever the second derivative is positive, the original function is going to be concave up. So it's going to have a shape something like this. And then when the second derivative is negative, it's going to be concave down. So a shape something like this. So now we have the information we need to write down our answer. We were asked where were the intervals of concave up and concave down, and also for any inflection points. Okay, so it's concave up from negative infinity to zero, right? So numbers less than zero in interval notation, negative infinity to zero, two to infinity. Okay, so both those intervals are places where it's concave up. Okay, and then it's concave down from zero to two. And then my inflection points are places where the concavity changes. Okay, and in this case, that happens at x equals 0 and x equals 2. And I forgot to mention this before, but just like when you're working with the first derivative, you just kind of want to note that these points, these critical points, are actually in the domain of the original function, right? Because I couldn't call it an inflection point if it wasn't in the domain of the original function. That would make sense. So in this case, my original function, if you remember, was a polynomial. So it's continuous for all real numbers. So 0 and 2 are in its domain. So that's good. I can call them inflection points. So inflection points at x equals 0 and x equals 2. So this tells us about the concavity of the function. So let me quickly show you a graph of this function to show you what concavity looks like on a graph. Okay, so here's a graph. So we said that there was an inflection point at x equals 0. So... and that makes sense, right? So over here, let's see, let me do this in red. So over here, this is concave up, right? The graph is opening up. But then at some point along here, it's at x equals 0, of course, we change to concave down, right? My function is now pointing down or opening down. And then my next inflection point was at x equals 2 right here. So I change back to opening up. And the second derivative gives us this information.